The title of this is becoming H plus. H plus is the symbol for transhumanism, right? More than human, more than Homo sapien. That's the code name you hear people use quite a bit, H plus. Now, if you didn't see the last update, it's important for you to understand what we're doing today. The last update, which was update 4, which was a little bit over a month ago, was about the organizational mind. And so what I said at that time was, it's very important with AI to understand kind of what the end in mind is, especially when you're thinking about strategy. Instead of just trying to move a little bit forward with AI every year, you need to have a good picture in your head of what are we trying to accomplish. So we, in update 4, we showed what we're trying to accomplish in organizations is creating the organizational mind. This update is about what is it going to look like with AI in our personal relationships. In other words, AI in our lives. Now, whether that's our careers or whether that's our personal lives, we want to paint the picture today of what that's going to look like. For those of you who did not get a chance to see update 4, a couple things. First of all, if you look in chat right now, you will see a link to update 4. And so you can go there. That's a recorded version. Obviously, don't go watch it now, but you can click on it, put it on a tab. If you want to, you can get caught up on update 4. All right, if you did see update 4, then you would know this graphic is one that we showed, just trying to paint the picture of what the organizational mind looks like. All right, so what it looks like is a collection of AI tools in an organization that creates a synthetic ambient intelligence layer. In other words, multiple AI engines all connected, in some ways talking to each other, educating each other, informing each other, creating a fully automated synthetic mind that is part of an organization. And every organization, I don't care what size, will have some version of this organizational mind, or what we sometimes just call the O-mind. That's the end in mind for what AI is going to look like when we talk about an organization. So let's now take a little bit of a separate journey to just talk about what AI will look like for us as individuals. All right, today we are primarily dependent on other people for help. So when we need something, whether we need knowledge or we need an activity done, right, it's typically other people who are going to go do that activity for us. It could be family members in our personal lives or friends. It could be coworkers in our, but we are dependent on other people generally for help, right? If we look at today or yesterday, we don't have the information to solve a lot of problems. Now, the internet has been very helpful, right? So the internet, I can Google something, I can look something up, so I can get help. I can YouTube a video on how to fix something. So we have more tools today, but we still lack a certain amount of information to solve a lot of the problems that we need solved in the world. The internet is not helping us with everything. And by the way, even if it's got the solution, sometimes it's hard to find, is this the right solution or the best solution? All right, we worry about people's judgment of us. So when we do ask for help, when we do need something in life, a lot of times we're worried about the judgment or being judged by somebody about asking for that help. Then think about the way we interact today. Today, generally as human beings, we interact with other human beings and pets, right? That's who we interact with. That's who we spend time with. That's who we get our emotional connection from, other human beings and pets. Now I say pets because I'm a dog person. I pretty much like all animals, right? But clearly, like, pets are something important that we interact with. All right, if we look at where we're headed with synthetic intelligence in our lives, and we look at how some of those things change, right? Well, we're not going to be just dependent on people anymore. We are going to have a digital assistant that will be able to help us, right? Now, you can call it a personal bot, we can call it all kinds of things, but it'll be a digital assistant that will help us from now on with many of the activities or things we have to do in life. Now, just a heads up, now that a lot of you are on this, right? I'm going to use many different words for what this digital assistant is, and I am doing that on purpose. We don't know what the final name of this digital assistant will look like, so just for fun, I'm going to use a number of different names for what it might end up being called. So I don't want you to I don't want that to throw you, and I'll try to kind of note that I'm switching names, right? But just know, right, I'm talking about a digital assistant that we will all have. Now, if you think about in the past, we didn't have all the information we needed to solve every problem, or we didn't know if that was the best solution. We are now going to have a personal assistant that harvests massive amounts of information on demand. Now, that could be in an instant if we need a decision quickly, or it could be over time, where we just have our digital assistant constantly searching the world for information or solutions that we might want. All right, whereas we were worried about people's judgment in the past, possibly when we needed help or we needed help on certain topics, no more, because we won't fear having judgment from our digital assistant. And then finally, that interaction, it's a bit different, right? It's not just now with humans and pets. We will also interact with these synthetic personas, right? These synthetic assistants, hence why you've seen the movies Her, right? Different movies, Ex Machina, right? So we have the different movies that are already starting to show us in science fiction that interaction between humans and a synthetic entity, right? Hey, just for fun, by the way, if you look in chat right now, you can see the average amount of time spent, right? So the average amount of time spent with people or the average amount of time spent with pets. Some of us might argue that we need to up the amount of hours spent with pets because they always love you no matter what. That's why those of us who are dog people as opposed to the cat people, because we all know the cats don't love you. All right. So in an H plus world, I want to stop and let's wrap our heads around that concept for a second, right? H plus, more than human. Right? So what happens when we can integrate with technology? We become hybrid, right? Hybrid where we have synthetic intelligence and then we have our human intelligence and we can integrate those things, you know, or even robotics, right? And we can integrate our bodies more and more with technology, right? At some point, we will become H plus. Now, you know, I always like to try to find videos that might show us H plus. We scoured the internet, the movie world, to try to find an appropriate one. Let's look at this one from the original Matrix, and let's talk for a second about being H+. All right, so an interesting example of being H+, in this case, being able to mix synthetic knowledge with the human knowledge, Neo is able to learn Kung Fu in 10 hours. Now, that was injected straight into his brain. I don't know that we're going to get there anywhere soon. But the concept of being able to grab huge amounts of knowledge at a speed we never had before, that is something that we are going to have, we're already starting to have with some of the AI tools that we've got. Now, if you look in chat right now, you're going to see an interesting statistic that we got through some of our research. So every year we produce what's called the Humalogy Trends Report. And we have surveyed thousands of people to come up with this information. One of the interesting things that we saw from our last year of surveying people was this 91% would increase the amount of technology they use to become more productive. And so maybe that's not a surprise to anybody, but it means there's still a huge hunger to be able to be more hybrid, to integrate more and more technology to be able to help us be more productive in our personal lives and at work. If you haven't seen the Humalogy Report, it was just released in the last week. So, you know, feel free to hit the link and you'll be able to download that report. Again, I don't want you to look at the report while I'm talking, right? This is live. So just get the report, look at it later when you get a chance. All right, let's continue to unpack what we're talking about when we talk about the synthetic intelligence or we talk about our synthetic assistant. And if you say, well, hey, what would those be, right? What would the synthetic assistant do for us? Like what kind of intelligence might they have, right? You're going to see the first playing around with words right now. right? Syntelligence, right? Sometimes when we just talk about syntelligence, it's just the contraction of synthetic intelligence, right? It's a different way of talking about AI, but as you know, we do not like the term artificial in artificial intelligence. So for us, we would be glad to rename it syntelligence. All right, if you will think about types of syntelligence, here is what our AI companion will have that we will use all of our lives. Now, it will straight up have knowledge. So it will be a retention of knowledge. So over the course of our lives, when we want to go know more about a topic, instead of just searching on Google to go find a link, read a little bit, we put it into our brains and then it's gone, unless we try to save it somewhere, which almost nobody does. We will now have an ability to have an AI assistant be able to hold knowledge for us on whatever topics we want it to hold knowledge of, so that all of our life, when we want to access that specific knowledge that we had our assistant go get, it is sitting there, right? It is holding a base of knowledge that we would like to retain for our lifetime. All right, now, if you look at some of what's going on with Microsoft right now and what they're looking at doing with the Windows operating system, it's not just knowledge that I've asked the assistant to go get. It is knowledge of every keystroke I've ever hit. It's knowledge of every document I've ever created. It is holding knowledge about me that it can reference anytime. 30 years back, it's going to be able to go back and say, what document did I create on this day? What was the format of that document? You would never lose a document ever again, or a version of a document, because your assistant will always be holding the knowledge of everything you've ever done. Now, that might sound scary to some people, right? But I think people in the future will look at this as a huge upgrade, that we have an AI assistant that has knowledge of us over the course of a lifetime. All right, a separate kind of knowledge is just the creative or the generative. You know, what we're becoming very familiar with over the last couple years, right? Knowledge of how to create what I want to create. I'll show you like one thing just to make this come true for you. You've been looking at graphics. The graphics in this were all created with Midjourney. They were all created with what's called a style reference code or an SRef code. So we use the same SRef code for every picture, which meant that the style, the color scheme all stayed consistent. Do everything that we did here. Why? Because our Midjourney, right, knew that we wanted to use this style reference. So when it was helping us to be creative, right, it had that knowledge that it was retaining. Well, imagine when you have 20 different SRef codes for different styles that you like, and anytime you want to create a graphic, you can just refer to a specific SRef code. Your AI assistant would know what that is. So that's a type of intelligence that your AI assistant will have. All right, predictive, being able to predict things. Now, we've understood predictive analytics for years, but you know what we haven't thought about is what happens when you have your own helper, right? Your own synthetic helper that is able to do predictions for you on anything you want, where you can ask it, hey, what do you think the stock price will be at such and such a time? And it'll give you a reasonable answer. Or you can say, hey, at my current health rate, right? You know what my health statistics are. You're pulling it off my Oura Ring and my Apple Watch, right? Tell me how long you think I'll live. Tell me when I will start having joint problems, when I need to start worrying about heart problems. Not just the general information that the healthcare community gives you, me specifically, when do I need to worry about these things, right? Predictive syntelligence, being able to talk to your synthetic assistant and get predictions. All right, prescriptive. Also having your synthetic agent be able to tell you, well, here's what we should do. Like here's a suggestion of what we should do, whether that's a change in behavior, a change in tactics, a change in process, a change in vendors, right? A prescription for how can we make this situation better. All right. Health and wellness, I've touched on, but just most people agree that maybe one of the more powerful places we will see artificial intelligence show up is just in health and wellness. And there's lots of good reasons for this. Not only can it speed up science, not only can it speed up diagnostics, right? It can speed up understanding in detail how our body is operating uniquely and give us unique advice. So think about having a digital assistant that's pulling 30 fields of information off your body every second of every day for years, and what it will be able to tell you about your health and wellness. All right, and then finally, I will just, I'll end on this one. You know, it will have an ability to take action. So it's not only that it has all these types of intelligence, it also understands how you might want to take actions. Now, today we call that agents or agentic. And if you look in chat right now, we pushed into it what the definition of agentic is, because we're hearing more and more that term, agentic AI. And what that means is an AI tool, right, or assistant that can go do work on your behalf. And so your synthetic assistant will also be able to go out and do activities on your behalf. And so we will think about that as it acting as your agent. Now, that means if you want to go purchase something, you don't have to go to Amazon, try to find it yourself, click. You could just tell your digital assistant, go buy this. It knows what your credit card number is, so it knows what credit card to put it on. It knows the best place to buy it to get it to you the fastest, right? It would be your shopping bot, but it would make reservations for you. It could make healthcare appointments for you, right? It goes and does work on your behalf. So I'm just trying to build up a bit of a picture for you. Like these are the types of intelligence and capabilities that will become normal that we will all have when we have an assistant, right? A synthetic assistant helping us. All right, so if you can hold that in your mind, let's talk a little bit more about this digital companion, right? And let me try to break this down and make it more real for you. First of all, we're going to be able to customize it, right? How it looks, how it sounds, how it talks. This should be no surprise. We're already starting to see these kinds of things where we have AI tools that we can change their voice. I mean, we can do that with OpenAI today. We can go on Synesthesia. We can change the look of a AI persona, right? So what we know is as we grow up, we might want this synthetic assistant to look different, to sound different. And so we know that we will change it as our tastes change over time. We will know that there will be people who will make money by providing very unique voices or unique looks to that companion. So anyway, just wanted to make sure that you understood that. All right, we're gonna end up paying big tech companies lots of money to be able to host or store our synthetic or digital companion. If you look at history and just kind of move forward, it'll be free at first. And then what they will do is, if you want more power, if you want your digital companion to have more capabilities, then you will have to pay an upcharge. If you want it to store 20 or 30 years of history on you, which you will, then you'll have to pay for it to store all of that history. And so just understand, this is going to become a huge revenue area for big tech companies, also just another expense that we will have, but it will be worth it because nobody's going to want to run with a generic digital companion. You're going to always want one that is customized. Now, you know how I feel about predicting the future, right? I believe the future's not exactly the same, but it rhymes. I believe the seeds are often planted years before we see what blossoms. So it isn't that hard to necessarily predict the future. If you just look at what we're already doing with Alexa, with building custom GPTs or Copilot or Siri, right? If you just look at some of those tools, we already are getting customized where they know our voice, or they can be tuned to look just like us, or we can use 11 Labs to have an AI that sounds exactly like us or exactly like anybody else that we want them to sound like. So a lot of the seeds are being planted today for the infrastructure that will become this digital companion. All right, let's look at kind of the lifetime of the digital companion. First of all, I want to think about it this way. Like, this is something that will be a forever companion for the future generations. I'm also always interested that, you know, you have Gen X and Gen Z, Gen Y, right? The generation that's being born today is Gen A. And in a funny thing about the world, it is this Gen A that in many cases will grow up into a world where they never know anything but an AI world. In other words, some of Gen A being born now or being born over the next decade will grow up with synthetic companions. Now, crude today, synthetic companions, but go forward over the next 10 years, the synthetic companions will become more and more sophisticated for this Gen A, which will be the first generation that grows up with a forever synthetic companion. And let me try to paint that picture for you a little bit. At first, what will happen is the children will have toys. And the toy, if you think about like a Teddy Ruxpin, right, which was famous for a while, they will have a toy that talks. It will have a lightweight AI companion built into the toy. Now, that'll be a little bit more expensive toy, possibly, or could be a very inexpensive toy because it's a way for big tech to get kids hooked on having a synthetic companion. We will see. But one thing I know for sure, we will buy a toy for our kids that has a synthetic companion built into it. It will know them, it will help them, it will help them learn. There will be all kinds of reasons why, as parents, we will say, yes, we want our child to have that synthetic companion. That's act one. All right, act two, as they get older, it will help with their education. So let's just say as they get from 2 years old to 6 years old, and now they go to school, right? From 6 years old for a while, this synthetic companion will move out of the toy and onto the screen. It's the same companion they've known since they were 2 years old, but it is now on a screen. Sure, they may change its name. They may change the way it looks, the way it sounds. It's the same companion. It knows them. It's known them since they were 2 years old. But now, its mission will be to help them with their education. And again, we will want this synthetic companion for our children because it is so effective at helping them with their education. Act three, we go to work, we get into our career, right? We're now in our young 20s, right? As we embark on a career, we find that this synthetic companion becomes an absolutely powerful assistant to help us, especially early in our career. It can answer all questions about the industry that we're in. It can do predictive analytics, prescriptive, right? It has an ability to help us make all kinds of decisions that are difficult when you're 22, 23, 24, 25, just getting into the workplace. That's act three. Act four, it's going to keep us company when we get older. So now let's say we're towards the end of our working career, we're towards that retirement age. Right, and now there's not as many people around us anymore, right? And we want more company. This synthetic companion will have been around since we were 2 years old. It will know us. It will be able to create a relationship with us that we will think is valuable when we get older, and we just need to spend time with something or someone who knows us. Then Act Five, which already is here, by the way, is what happens when we pass. And so when we pass away, if you look in chat right now, you can see a link to two sites, the Hereafter AI and Storyfile, which are companies that will help organize your voice, your look, your face, a lot of your history, and put it into, you can call it a chat bot if you want, right? But it's a synthetic version of a loved one that you can talk to. You can ask it questions about itself, and it will tell you about itself from many pieces of data that were uploaded. In other words, we can recreate a loved one who has passed. And the way that I think you should probably look at this as, when I was younger, a lot of you, we had scrapbooks or we had the photo albums of our grandparents. And that's all we had left after they died was the photo albums and some pictures. We are right now at a place where the photo album will change. And it will now be a digital family tree that if we want to talk to our grandparents or our great-grandparents, we can just click on it and we can just talk to them, see how they talked, listen to them, hear their stories. Now, you might think that that's a little creepy. I don't think this is going to be creepy at all to future generations. I think they will see this as a wonderful way to be able to know who the people up the family tree were, as opposed to only having that photo book to look at. All right, so in chat, we have a question. Wouldn't there be an act that will help you parents? Yes. I mean, I'm trying to give the high-level acts, but yes, I think actually all through these, there will be a lot of customizations we can do to the synthetic companion to help with our kids. And so some of those we might have to pay for, some of them we won't. But I think it's a great question, yes. I think all through it, parents will be able to consult with the synthetic companion up until, let's say, their children are 18, to be able to help tune it, right, to help them do a better job as a parent. However, we also have to understand there'll be some legal issues around, hey, when will a young person want their parents to not have the ability to mess with their synthetic companion? You know, legally today, that might be 18, but we might see some new law. Maybe that'll drop, right, where you can't mess with your kid's synthetic companion, right, after 15. I mean, this is all new law that we will have to set, right, and try to see what happens. All right, we'll work on letting you copy the chat stream. That's just a setting that we have to set, so we'll work on that, see if we can do that, and we'll let you know if we get that turned on. All right, what if we could use the knowledge of your great-great-grandparents for parenting guidance? It would be interesting, but they would be so different from such a different generation. You know, it would be more just chatting with your great-great-grandparents, probably asking them, what would you do in this situation, right? And then hearing what they said they would do. And in some cases, you might chuckle about what they would say, their advice. And in some cases, you might say, that was great advice. How did we lose that somewhere along the way? But Ken, it's a good observation. This is the way I want you to be thinking, right? Is, okay, well, what happens when we can turn synthetic companions into a wonderful facsimile of a loved one, right? And then have that for the rest of the generations? It's going to change a lot of things from what we have today. All right. This is an important topic we need to get to if we're going to talk about these synthetic assistants. This one's a bit philosophical, but I get this question a lot when I do Q&A on this topic with audiences. And what they'll say is, hey, is there ever going to come a time when this synthetic assistant becomes more sentient or cognitive or conscious, right? So we'll get asked that question. They will ask me things like, will it have a personality? Will it understand our emotions and will it care about us? Let me just take these a bit separately and then I'll answer a few of the questions in chat. First of all, I'm going to spend a couple slides talking about that first question, right? Will our companion be conscious, cognitive, or sentient? So let's look at, will it have a personality? Absolutely, it will have a personality. Much like we can tell ChatGPT today, or Claude, or any of the LLMs, we can ask them to adopt a different personality, and they do. And if any of you have played with these tools, you know what I'm talking about. It is not that hard. So yes, we absolutely will be able to push a personality if we want to. All right, will it be able to sense our emotions? Yes, in some cases better than other humans can. Something people don't understand about synthetic intelligence is it can sense emotions incredibly well. It may not have emotions, but it can sense the emotions in us. So that it can do. Will it care about us? In a manner of speaking. So you can actually program into an AI curiosity, right? So there are rules that you can tell an AI where you can say, you are this, or you behave this way. And it understands, it can translate that into behavior. So we will have an ability to say, hey, You know, we want this AI to care about our child, but we will have to define what care means. Like, what does that mean? What level of care, right? Things like that. So yes, the bottom three bullets, absolutely, we're going to have it. The top bullet, that's where we need to go through another slide. All right, let me answer a few of the questions that have come up. So Ron Warman, Ron, it's good to see you. Ron holds a very interesting event every year that is extremely thought-provoking. And so I know if you all don't know Ron, you ought to look him up online, right? Ron, W-O-R-M-A-N, and look up the event that he does. So he's just making a comment, right, about a company's a collection of people who all have digital assistants, right? As a business owner, will I be able to learn through every action they take, people perform roles? So this depends completely, Ron, on whether the company has any access to your personal assistant. And my guess is in some cases they will, but in most cases they won't. So in other words, if the company is funding and providing some type of assistant, digital assistant, then they'll have access to some of the information. But if you've had one since you were 2 years old that is yours and you're paying for it, they will have no access to it. I would liken that to where we are with digital phones today. If the company gives you a digital phone, they can wipe it, they can erase it, they can shut it down, they have some control over it. If you're bringing your own phone to work, generally you have complete control over that device. So I think it'll be a lot that way. All right, how do you imagine this artificial intimacy will impact mental health and loneliness of the population? Wow, that is a fantastic question. And one that I think about a lot because I do a lot around digital wellness and digital well-being. I have mixed emotions about the fact that this will give us a forever friend that for some people will become a very important relationship. I worry a little bit about that when their forever friend is not human because we were wired for human connection. And so I get a little bit concerned about, as you say it, the artificial intimacy, that is not the kind of intimacy we were wired to feel. And so synthetic intimacy, right, or artificial does cause me a little bit of concern. But I do think having a relationship with a pretty powerful system, right, that you can call on and use all your life has some advantages to it. All right, so let's go through AI and consciousness, and I'm going to need you all to get ready on chat because I'm going to start asking you questions, and I want you to put into chat yes and no, one or the other, right? Yes or no, and you are welcome, Ron, of course. So when we talk about consciousness, I let's define what is kind of human consciousness, what is consciousness in general, and then let's look at synthetic to answer this question. Will our synthetic companion have a form of consciousness? Now, there's an interesting exercise philosophers do. And they go through and they say, well, you know, there are different types of consciousness, right? So spiritual consciousness, right? God would have that. Then there's human consciousness. You're saying, no, I haven't even asked you the question yet. So here's the question. Do you believe that a large animal is conscious? Right? So now put in your yes or no. So a dog, right? A horse, a zebra, an elephant, a whale, right? Large animal. Are they conscious? All right. Excellent. I see a lot of streaming of yes. All right. So here is what I'm guessing you were saying no to. Let's switch, right? Do you believe that a synthetic intelligence can be conscious? Yes or no? All right now the no's are probably a little bit more than the yeses. I'm defining consciousness in a minute, so I know that when you're asking the question, what is consciousness, I'll do that on the next slide. Right now, I'm just curious your perceptions, so just, you know, play along, and then I'll try to define consciousness better for you. All right, let's look at a small animal. If I said a mouse, right? A mouse, if I said an insect, right? Are they conscious? Yes or no? A worm, right? So a very small, simpler animal, do you believe that they are conscious, yes or no? I like Ron, I like yours. We're going to get to a word for what Ron just said. All right. Plants. This is always interesting with audiences. Do you believe a plant is conscious? Trees, right? Think about trees. Trees have an ability to, you know, point their leaves at the sun. Some people say trees can communicate with each other. Do you believe plants have a form of consciousness? Is there plant consciousness? Yes or no? And it's interesting, we're getting more no's now. A yes and no. Very philosophical answer. So Ron, I agree with you. I'm a plants and trees are conscious guy. Here's the last one, a rock. Do you believe a rock is conscious? We now know Ron Werman believes that a rock is conscious. He said everything in the universe is conscious, everything in the universe. Ron is clearly in the minority. He is a group of one because everybody else believes a rock is not conscious. All right, so there are people, again, in a philosophical discussion, they might say, if you are just looking at levels of consciousness, right, it isn't so much about is it conscious, is it not? You might be able to think about it as levels of consciousness. In other words, maybe a small animal isn't quite as conscious as a human is, right? And you're welcome to keep throwing what you think in chat, all right? Let me kind of play out for you some interesting things. First of all, if you really wanted to study this philosophically, there's a difference between consciousness, sentience, and cognitive. And we're not going to take the time to go through all this. I'm just trying to show you. If you chat GPT this up just for fun, this is what you'd get, right? A really good explanation of the differences between consciousness, sentience, and cognition. And I just want to make sure I've used all three words. I'm talking about consciousness right now. But if you wanted to, you could look up those three. All right, let's go back to consciousness. So some of you said, hey, what is the definition of consciousness? Now, I have both talked to AI engines and studied this separately. Here's a list of what most people would cite, either one or more of these: awareness of self, understanding of one's environment, right? You understand what's around you, you're cognitive of what's around you, ability to learn and adapt, capacity to feel emotion, instinct for survival or achievement, ability to communicate, and a code of ethics. So this is typically what you'd see if you're trying to describe human consciousness. Now, alive is what some people will say. Hence, as soon as I said rock, you all were out, right? You were out because a rock's not alive. But as long as it was alive, some of you were struggling with whether it's conscious or not. I want to show you something, right? Just interesting thought process again, because we need to really think about, are our synthetic companions going to become somewhat conscious or sentient? Right? If we look at human, we might say, yeah, it's a yes on everything except for the code of ethics. The code of ethics, that's a bit inconsistent. You know, some humans have it, some humans don't have it. Most humans have a different code of ethics, but all the others typically a human has. If I were to go through, what does a synthetic system have? Does it have an awareness of self? Yeah, it's actually possible that an AI, right, or a synthetic system could be aware that that's what it is, right? It knows that's what it is. It knows it's not human. So it could. Understanding of the environment, absolutely an AI can understand its environment. It learns faster than humans do. The capacity to feel emotion, probably not the way we feel emotion in a biological way, but can it understand emotion enough to know an appropriate emotion to deliver? Yes, it could. Instinct for survival, yes, an AI can absolutely have an instinct for survival. It can communicate better than most humans. Does it have a code of ethics? Whatever ethics the people who built the AI program in other words, the guardrails. So whatever the guardrails are, that is the code of ethics for an AI. Is it alive? That's debatable. All right, there is a link that you saw pushed by Trent a little bit ago. And it's a website, and it talks about the conscious universe. And the reason that he pushed that is it is shows a definition, it's an article around what's called panpsychism. So what Ron Werman was referring to when he said everything in the world is conscious, or the world is conscious, the universe is conscious, so everything in it is conscious, that's called panpsychism. Panpsychism basically says that the atoms that are in the rock know that they are a rock. And if the atoms didn't have some level of consciousness, they wouldn't be able to hold together as a rock. All right, I know this is a lot, but I really wanted to make sure that you gave some thought to the fact that it is absolutely possible for our synthetic companions to become sentient or cognitive or much less maybe conscious. I think we are on the way there. So you ask, you know, why is the human code of ethics inconsistent, but it's not inconsistent with synthetic? It's a good question. I guess I would say because humans, their ethics are extremely fungible. Even the ethics they think they have in different situations, they break those ethics. So it's very inconsistent for humans what they even say their ethics are or if they even perform on the ethics they say they believe. In an AI, once the guardrails are set, then typically the AI is not going to break the guardrails unless somebody's trying to hack the system. Now, you are right, though, that the guardrails are programmed in by humans. And so that does make them inconsistent across OpenAI's guardrails versus Anthropic's versus Llama, right, versus Gemini, right? All of those have a different set of guardrails, which does make them inconsistent. So you are right about that. I was just trying to show the bigger picture a little bit of, hey, ethics in general. Humans are not great at ethics. Machines at least have some consistency once they're programmed. All right. From a platform standpoint, we already now have big tech vendors starting to put together these companions. And if we just look at what we need, right, to have the platforms and to have what I'm describing to you, we need a platform that can gather massive amounts of information. Because think about the amount of information on every one of us as individuals. Everything we ever typed, everything we asked for, everything we touched, every song we ever listened to, right, gets stored in our synthetic assistant. Right now, if you multiply that times millions and millions, billions of people, right, you can imagine that's a massive amount of data. So that's the first thing we're going to have is platforms that can store even more data than what we store today. Then we're going to need an AI engine that is trained to play this role, right? So it knows its job. It is motivated to play this role. What we're going to have specific AI engines, which leads you to believe there may be a Google synthetic companion, an IBM synthetic companion, you know, a Microsoft synthetic companion, an OpenAI synthetic companion. So our synthetic companion may have a lot to do with what was the toy that we bought at 2 years old, right? Or we bought for our two-year-old. And who was the vendor behind that toy, right? And then did we change somewhere along the line? And if you did, is there any portability of your data from one vendor to another when it comes to synthetic companions? It's a little bit like cloud today, right? Having a cloud vendor and then trying to do portability. All right. We're going to have an ability to connect to many digital systems because your synthetic companion's an agent. So in an agentic world, if you want it to go to work on your behalf, it's going to have to be able to connect to many, many different systems, hundreds of systems, maybe thousands of systems, to be able to do all the actions or gather all the information that you want. So that's got to be a capability of the platforms. It's got to learn. It has to have an ability to learn. Constantly learning, always trying to gain information that might help us out. All right, will there be a synthetic companion paired to implanted augmentation chips? So if you mean a BC, right, a brain-computer interface, a BCI, sure. Absolutely. I mean, we'll just make sure that we can connect a BCI to communicate with our companion. So now maybe we can communicate without actually talking or typing. So no question that when you look at Neuralink or things like that, we'll combine a synthetic companion with that kind of capability, especially if you think about somebody that is physically disabled and what power we could give them if they could connect a Neuralink to a synthetic companion that could go to work on their behalf. All right. All right, last thing, there's got to be a revenue model, right, to pay for all this. So again, either we're going to be paying a subscription fee, or if we look at what's happened in the past, big tech's going to say, well, we'll give you this for free, but we have access to all your data. None of it's private. You know, same way that a Facebook or Instagram, you know, works today, or Gmail, right? So we may have both. If you want a free synthetic companion because you can't afford one, great, we'll provide it, but we get access to all the data in your synthetic companion, which means our advertising capability to you will be unbelievable because we will know you so well. Or you can pay for the privacy. If you pay for it, then we don't have access to all your data. Pretty much we know we'll end up here. So there you go. There's what it looks like from a platform standpoint. I'm going to use my last version of the word, a symbiote. Right? Maybe what we end up calling these are symbiotes. And I would say these are four things when I think about a symbiont, right, that are probably going to be true. Right? It's reasonable to understand that these tools are going to be have a massive impact on people's ability to prosper or not. So at 2 years old, if I get a more powerful tool and I'm able to add to that power faster than everybody around me, by the time I am a 12-year-old, my symbiote would be much more powerful than other 12-year-old, ergo making me more powerful. Now, that's predicated on the second comment here, right? Whoever can afford the best systems, right, and can highly educate those symbiotes or buy every extra tool available for the symbiote, they're going to give an advantage to whoever is the human partner of the symbiote. In the work world, will be judged by that. Think about going and doing an interview where they ask you, well, what kind of symbiote do you use? What kind of upgrades does your symbiote have? Right? What does your connection look like with the symbiont? What capabilities does it have versus what you have? That's going to be happening in interviews, and that sounds science fiction, but I'm sure it's coming. And then the last one, add those three things up. Now we got to talk more about the digital divide. Right? Think about the problems that we have with the digital divide, where those who can afford to build and buy very powerful symbiotes from 2 years old of their child all the way up. Think about the advantage they have versus the people who have to use the free version, right? Where they're getting advertised to and it doesn't have the same level of power. This is a whole different dimension than do you have a good laptop and good fast bandwidth in your house? Right? It's a whole nother level that we need to be worried about when we think about society in general. All right. I think we could probably kind of wrap up, you know, this thought about how much symbionts will change us, how much they'll change us, and how much they will change the world. If you look at how much the internet has changed people, how much mobile devices have changed people, if we just look at those two, now, they've changed everything from how educated people are. They've changed where people can work from. They've changed what people are exposed to as far as knowledge, good and bad. Right? It has been a huge impact on society, the internet to mobile, right, to now something like this, right? The merger of the synthetic world with individuals. So we are very influenced today by the people around us. Like, that's the biggest influence. Now, the second biggest influence is what's online. But if we look at tomorrow and you ask, what's going to be the biggest influence? Think about that symbiont that you first met when you were 2 years old. And it's been with you all of your life. It knows you better than anyone else. It knows questions you've asked. Nobody else knows you've ever asked those questions. It knows knowledge that you have that no one else knows you have. right? So just think about how different that becomes, right? Where it isn't just your family and friends that are influencing you. You have a synthetic, right, companion, a symbiote that is able to impact you, help you, and it will change you. And it will change you based a bit on how powerful yours is and the relationship you build with it over time. It's interesting to think about. All right, so let's wrap this up. I did this same type of graphic in update 4. I'm just going to do it from a different angle. So if you, again, didn't see update 4, go back and watch, and you'll understand what we're doing with this graphic. But I want you to think about integrated intelligence. If you just look back at the year 2000 and we look all the way up to 2050, and we say, all right, what is technology doing to integrate intelligence for us? Right? Well, if you look at how humans learn, human capabilities over generations go up and to the right, but they go up and to the right slowly. We don't learn as fast as AI learns. We can't transfer information very efficiently to younger people. It takes a long time to learn any specialty, right? So human capabilities go up and to the right over generations, but slowly. Whereas, if you look at symbiote capabilities, like these companions we are talking about, their capabilities are going to go up and to the right dimensionally because AI has the ability to learn much faster than we do. So what will happen if you build hybrid capabilities is it will drag up or it will speed up the pace that humans can learn or the capabilities we have to go do activities or make better decisions, to do science, to invent things, to be creative. And if you think about words like the singularity that I've mentioned in transhumanism, and you look at the dates across the bottom, and you say, all right, well, certainly by the 2030s, we're going to hit the singularity, and that's going to be when an AI tool can solve problems we can't solve. It knows more than any group of human beings. And you say, okay, well, then we ultimately get to transhumanism, right? We're now no longer Homo sapien, right? We now have transitioned to Homo robotus or Homo technologists or whatever the next version is. The opportunity for us is this gap between having only human capabilities and having the hybrid capabilities of building a relationship with us intelligence, right? That's the good news. There's a lot of news that could be bad news about doing this. But the good news is we have the capacity from this point forward to pair up with these types of tools, these relationships that we can build, and they will help us to be able to speed up any kind of progress we're trying to make as human beings. Now, I just did two podcasts where I did a redefinition of the word singularity and transhumanism. So if those words still throw you a little bit, go to the podcast. The links are here, right? And just listen. They're 30 minutes each. And I just redo the definitions of the singularity and transhumanism. And you might find the new definitions interesting to you. All right. I know that was a lot. And I just wanted to remind you, if you're listening and you love thinking about these end in mind, like what is the high beam vision? What is the end in mind for AI? You know, we have our think tank coming up, our in-person think tank in October. And it is all going to be on human capital management and digital capital management. And how do you integrate these for an accretive outcome? In other words, 1 + 1 = 3. So in this new synthetic intelligence driven world, which will be a bit of a different world, what will human capital mean in a company? What will digital capital mean in a company? And how do we better integrate them? That's what the think tank is going to be this year. Definitely a worthy topic for sure. All right. And the next update, update 6 is going to be Hart Brown. And Hart's going to be talking about, what will happen based on which presidential candidate gets selected. And if we look at that from kind of a technology standpoint, what have they proposed, right? Because they propose different things. They are very different presidential candidates. what might the future look like from a technology standpoint, depending on which one gets elected. And that's going to be on September 26th. So that's our next update. All right. We've got a few minutes for questions. And I know there were probably a chunk of questions that flew by and I couldn't catch all of them. But I'm glad to answer any questions for anybody in our couple minutes we have left. So if anybody's got an interesting one, go ahead and throw it out. I'll be glad to answer. Just while I'm waiting for see if somebody has a question, just remember, we record these. You will get the recording of this. So if you want somebody else to be able to just watch this, it's gonna come on. Right? In the next day or two, you'll see a link and then you can send that to somebody else. All right. Sounds good. I'm glad you're going to symbiotic AI on GoDaddy. Symbiont. Yeah. You got to beat us there because it's available for an inexpensive amount, just in case I'm right. All right. I don't see, well, Ron, reach out, email me, and let's talk, right? And I can help answer that question for you. All right, how do we protect ourselves from synthetic producers who are bad actors or who do not have our best interests in mind? Man, that is an awesome question that somebody needed to ask. If you ask yourself, what is cybersecurity issues going to look like with a symbiont? They're going to take over our symbiont, and they're going to make us pay to get it back. Like, that's the number one thing I worry about from protecting ourselves is, just like today when digital criminals take over a network and make you pay a ransom to get it back, they're going to do everything they can to take over your symbiont and lock it up, and then you'll pay to get it back. So that will be one thing that could happen. They could pollute it so they could get into the training of the symbiont and give it wrong answers so that when you ask advice, you might get wrong answers. These are all things that could happen. And so we're going to have to look at cybersecurity from a different lens than just a network today, right? Or data that's being stolen. It'll just be another digital asset we're going to have to try to protect. All right. Like a BFF app that can be on your phone or implanted to be best friend, your teacher, your Yep, you're right. I mean, that's absolutely what it's going to be like, Greg, is it'll be like a digital best friend. I just think that's where it could get dicey. Is for some people, just like the movie Her, it could become their real best friend. And that is probably something for us to worry a little bit about. Symbiont, so Robert, it could be either one, right? We're just playing around with words. Like, what could it end up being named, right? And that was just for fun, right? Who knows what it'll be called. It'll be something that we said today, my guess. But anyway, we were just playing around that some of those were available on the internet or available on GoDaddy for the low, you know, they're available. So we were just playing around with, should we go grab it? And then we thought, well, we'll give you a chance. If you grab it before us, fine. If you don't, we'll go grab it. All right. Could it be weaponized to steal data or money? Oh, absolutely. It can and it will. I mean, these symbionts, these digital assistants, they will be weaponized. And people will try to steal the data. They will try to get money from people in different ways. The more you love something that's digital, the more you will pay to get it back. All right. Same thing if you left your phone somewhere and somebody said, hey, I got your phone. I need $100. I'll bring it back to you. You'll pay it, right? Because you care that much about your phone. It's going to be the same thing with these. All right. Thank you. You know we like to end on time, and it is that time. So I appreciate you all showing up. Please send the recordings to anybody else if you'd like. Hart will be doing number 6. Make sure you show up and attend that one. That will be extremely interesting. All right, see you all later.